I'd like to invite us all to join in a moment of silence as we commemorate the 11th hour of the 11th month of the 11th year, and the anniversary, the 99th anniversary of the signing of the armistice, which effectively ended World War I. Please join me in a moment of silence. Holy One, in this time when we commemorate the signing of an armistice that ended a war, we also remember all of the veterans who have given their lives. And we pray and we ask for your guidance as we move to act toward a time when all guns will be silenced. Amen.
Good morning.
I want to thank the first panel. That was not only educational, but inspiring. Thank you. I'm Jack Jowett. I'm pleased to be here, but humbled to be in the company of so many wonderful and accomplished people. I was generally aware of Jane Addams and her founding qualities, but with Red Platt's encouragement, I've come to understand and appreciate the pioneering work and leadership of this extraordinary woman. She indeed speaks to us today. I'm a recent migrant from Oregon to Western Massachusetts. My settling in Northampton has been deepened and strengthened by my involvement with the Edwards Church Circle of Care, which is accompanying an Iraqi refugee family. This has reinforced my concern for refugees and immigration issues. My wife, who said I should write this down rather than give a sermon, and I have spent most of the last 50 years working internationally, primarily in Africa. My career, thus my insight, comes from directing the American Friends Service Program in Southern Africa when Zimbabwe was still Rhodesia. A Peace Corps director in Tanzania and Uganda, a Foreign Service leadership assignments with USAID in Somalia in the early 90s as this state disintegrated, and managing U.S. assistance programs in Rwanda following the genocide in 1994. I became involved with a novel peace-building program in the 90s, now called Interpeace, and I've supported the identification and initiation of national peace-building programs in several countries. I thought I was retired, and then in 2012, through personal and professional relationships, I found myself spending about half of my time in Mogadishu, Somalia, as a personal advisor to the presidency. My journey involves my involvement with conflicts and the conditions that create the internally displaced and refugee camps. I've been in the camps. Jane Addams' early important work addressed the conditions of the Hull House neighborhood, which was one of immigrants and laborers of working class Chicago in the 1890s. It was a period of rapid industrialization and change. Millions of people had migrated to America in the preceding years. To a largely immigrant population, Hull House offered everything from kindergarten and daycare facilities to libraries and an employment bureau. It provided meeting places for trade unions that brought diverse people together. This pioneering work led Jane Addams to explore and understand the complex issues and lives of immigrants, which helps her interest in peace and international, which seeded her interest in peace and international collaboration. Her work emphasized inclusiveness, building community, and collaboration. We face many of the immigration and refugee issues that Mrs. Addams faced 130 years ago. Quotas, cries of America first, strident nationalism, the scapegoating of immigrants. You know, if citizens need to blame someone, governments frequently help them. Racism, arbitrary changes in the law, immigration issues fostered by war and conflict, prejudices reflected in public life and politics. Does any of that sound familiar? The challenges remain, and the world is a much more complicated place today. The U.S. has a rather uneven history regarding naturalization, immigration, and refugees. There have been well over 30 legislative acts and dozens of amendments to those acts since the first Naturalization Act of 1790, which restricted naturalization to free white persons of good moral character. Many of the acts spoke to our social and political issues and were influenced by events outside the U.S. For instance, the 1970 Act, which the 1870 Act, which allowed blacks to be naturalized. The Chinese Exclusion Act of 1887, not repealed until 1943. The ad hoc numeric quota systems of the 20s. The first real refugee provisions of 1948, which were followed then by the Communist Exclusion Act of 1952. Over a century, there have been many changes in the laws governing immigration and refugees. Shifts in the law are frequently due to complex combinations of changing public perceptions and values, politics, and legislative compromise. Wars I and II produced changes due to the upheavals in Europe and Asia. The situation with Cuba, the Vietnam War, the rise and fall of the Soviet Union, the emergence of new nations have all produced changes in immigration and refugee regulations. And then there have been the changes related to balancing demands for skilled and unskilled labor. Although the U.S. has been the largest recipient of refugees, over 2 million since 1982, the federal financial support has steadily decreased in the last decade, increasing the burden on resettlement agencies, on the states, and on local communities. Today, it's estimated that over 65 million people have fled their homes or are on the move today. That is, people who have been forced to leave their homes. You do not leave your home easily. You do not leave your home easily. Half of these people are internally displaced, meaning they are temporarily within their own countries and would prefer to return home. I think the number of displaced persons will grow, given climate change, the substitution of war for diplomacy, and the struggles of new and older nations to find governing mechanisms that deal with inclusion, identity, religion, and ethnic issues. I'm honored to be moderating this panel. I'm sitting with people who model James Addams' values, vision, and commitment. Their lives and works speak to our common humanity and the need for all of us to engage in the social, cultural, historical, political, and ethical issues of our time. Two of the panel need no introduction to most of you, as they have long leadership positions in Northampton and the Pioneer Valley. Bill Newman, the director of Western Regional Law Office of the ACLU, has been locally and nationally recognized for his leadership on civil rights and social justice. He has received numerous awards and public recognition. He is also an author, a columnist, and a radio program host. Lori Millman serves as the executive director of the Center for New Americans. Her leadership has evolved a dynamic community-based nonprofit adult education center. The center provides the underserved immigrant, refugee, and migrant communities of Massachusetts Pioneer Valley with an array of services that enable refugees and migrants to gain the skills and tools necessary for economic independence. Bill and Lori will follow Sohair Arno, who is seated on my left. I've come to know Sohair in the last couple of months. She is a proud refugee from Sudan and from Southern Sudan, who arrived in Western Massachusetts a few months ago. I identified with her as I've been to Darfur and I've been to Juba in Southern Sudan. I think her story would be appreciated by Jane Addams. We should remember that every refugee, every migrant, has a unique story, and those stories should be honored. Sohair is a refugee from the troubled Nuba Mountain area of South Kordofan province of Sudan. The province is on the southern border of Sudan and thus adjacent to the new and troubled nation of South Sudan. The Nuba peoples had been bombed and persecuted for over a decade. Sohair will share her story, one of determination, long journeys, violence, persecution, faith, loss, and good fortune. She's the mother of three wonderful kids who are sitting down there, who are here to support and witness their mother's participation. She is representative of the challenges facing migrants and refugees. Your questions are welcome, but we'll wait till after the panel's presentations. Thank you.
Hi, good morning. Nice to have all of you to share with me my story and the journey to USA. My name is Sohair Arno. I'm from Nuba Mountain, that is in North Kordofan region. That is the area between South Sudan and Sudan now. So this area in the middle now become an area of fighting. This area is not, there are many people that they are Christian, they are Muslim, they are non-believer. So the Khartoum people now, they want to remove this area out because of their culture and because of their race. So I grew up there since long time, 13 years ago. And on the area, It is not safe because there is no school, no education. So my family, they decided to move to another area called Abu Bayt. And in Abu Bayt, I found my education from the missionaries' school, Kamboni school, so that is belong to the Catholic Church. I grew up in a family, my father, he is a Muslim, he is non-believer, and my mom, she's Christian, and my grandparents, they are non-believer. So when my father moved to Khartoum, because the place is not, they forced the people to be Muslim, so he came easily to become a Muslim person. But my mom, she is a very strong lady. She said, I will never change my faith. And we follow her because she has values in life. We didn't follow our father. We follow her, I always go with her to the church. We always attend the mass, so that is how I grow. In my father's side of his family, our grandparents, he is a popular chief of the tribe. His name is Arun. Maybe one day, if you have time and you visit the museum in England, you can know about this chief Arun. He has a sculpture there in UK. So, I grew up as a displaced child in North Sudan because of the fighting and because my family, they are very poor at that time. But my mom, she tried her best. And me, I do my best in my education. And I get a scholarship from the Catholic Church. They give me a scholarship so I can continue my study. So after that, I get my high diploma. And then the Catholic Charity again, they give me some help. And I get my education in Khartoum University. I got a scholarship because I have a high mark in my education from the government too. So I study science, environmental science in Khartoum University. And Khartoum University, they don't give me this scholarship because they love me, but they need me to change my destination. They need me to change all my things. So that is how it worked. But I thank God, he is with me all the time. So I finished my education and I said, let me go to my family back home. So I returned back home to Nuba Mountain and I stayed there. And I helped the people as to teach them about nutrition, to teach the women about how to ride, because most of the women in Nuba Mountain, they don't get their education. And at that time, that is 2005. So again, at that time, the South Sudan, they need to take their independence. So that at that time, the situation is not good in Nuba Mountain because most of our people, they are army with South Sudanese people. So the government said to help the South Sudanese people to get their own country, we will teach you a lesson. So they come again and they make problem in the area, and that is in 2011. And at that time, I start my journey till I come here. So at that time, I lost one of my sister and I lost most of my family because we have to survive so we can find life. So I came to South Sudan. And then I came to a place called Eden. It is in the middle between South Sudan and North Sudan, in a border. So I came there walking, and even I lost my husband because I know where is he now. But I came with my two kids at that time, and I was pregnant with my small one. He's 5 years old now. So we walked a long distance from Nuba Mountain up to Eden. It took me a long distance, it took me 10 days, and I walked about 8 miles, 800 miles. So it is a long distance. Many people, they are dying on the street. Many people, they just fall down and leave them like that because there is no dying, there is bombing, there is aeroplane. So it is very hard, really. So, and we are walking, there is no water, no food. So it is very hard. But we try to get to our destination. We try to move ahead. Even we lost so many people that we love, but we said, let us move, let us gain our life. So when I came to Eden, still there is no option for life, no school, no food. We live in a camp. That is camp belong to UN people, but there is no safety, no security. There is nothing. So I said, I have two kids and I am pregnant at that time. How can we live? And there is no school for the kids and education is my first things. How can I get things for my kids? So I said, okay, let me move again to Juba. So I moved to Juba, South Sudan. Even Juba is not a safe place. There are many struggling. There are many problems, fighting, robbing, all the things that I found it in Nuba Mountain, still I found it in Juba. So I stayed in Juba for 2 years and something. At that time, I get out my son, I deliver my son, Juba, the last born, now he's 5 years old. And I said, okay, how can I live here? We don't have food, we don't have anything. There is many struggling. Let us move to another place. And I hear that in Egypt, you can find life. It is not good life, but at least you can find the things, the need that you like. So I moved to Egypt by the help of the care. They helped me for the tickets of the flight. So I moved to Egypt. From Egypt, I start the journey with the UNHCR. UNHCR is the United Nations for Refugees. So that is how it took me a long time, 5 years, till I came here to USA. And even life in Egypt is not an easy life. So you have to work as a refugees, you have to look after your kids, and even the kids to walk in the street alone is very difficult. And even you as a mother, as a single mother, to walk alone and to look after the kids is not difficult, it is not easy. So I said, how can I make it between my kids and walk so I can give them life, so I can rent my house, because there is nothing will be given to the refugees at Egypt. You have to depend on yourself. No food, no house rent, no camp, there is nothing. So you have to look for your kids. So I found the school for my kids, that is African Hope Learning Center for Refugees Kids. And I registered my two kids there, but I have a problem of the youngest one. Because the baby care is very expensive. So I said, let me work as a teacher. I am a teacher before, let me continue. Even the salary is not good, but I said, let me do something. Let me try to change the life of many kids, because there are many kids, they need our help. And nobody except to take this low salary. So I start to work in African Hope Learning Center. Most of the kids, they came from the broken family. Most of them, they lost hope. Most of them, they are orphaned. Even the mother, some of them, they have stress, they have trauma because the situation is hard. So maybe they will not take care of the kids. So from that time, I know that is like a mission for me to help these kids. I try to help them, to support them, to encourage them because all of them, they look at themselves down, some of the teenagers. They look at themselves down because the Egyptian, they insult all the people at the street. They say, hey, you black people, hey, you brown people, like that. They just insult us all the time. I just tell them, and that is our color, and that is God give it to us. So we have to be proud. What is your job? Go and ask God if you don't like us because we are brown or black. So and I also encourage my students, don't listen to these Egyptian boys and girls, because they are not, they don't have any hope. They can just die, they can just do anything. But look at yourself. You came from the suffering area because you know that you have a good future. You know that you have, God has a good plan for you. So don't waste your time with them. Just continue, go ahead. So that is how my students, they deal with these things. So when I make the decision to be with the UNHCR, it takes me a long distance and it takes me a long time. Many interviews, many, you have to go to UNHCR to give you the yellow card. After that, when they read your story, they said, okay, maybe that he is able to be not a refugee even, as Islam seekers. So after that, maybe it will take with you two years, then they will give you the blue card. After they will give you the blue card, again they will give you many interview, and many people, lawyers, they just come and sit maybe like 4 or 5 to hear about your story. Are you really a refugee or you just create a story? So, and it takes me a long time. Then the people, the lawyer from Washington, they came to Egypt and they hear my story too. And I have to wait for them another 1 year. After they study my case, then they said, now from here, you can go to USA. And it takes from me a long time till again our lovely president, he came and he said he makes some borders for the people that Sudan is not from the country, that they will not be able to come here. But I thank God, even through all these struggling, through all these things, I come even among all these problems. So when I came here, I start to stay in Springfield with some of my family, not family, community, from Sudanese community. I stay maybe 1 month. After that, I suppose to rent a house. But because I'm not working, and it is very hard to get my job, so God offered me somebody, now she is like my sister. God gave me a lady, her name is Tina, and she's very amazing lady. She offered me to live with her in the same house. Till now, I'm still living with her. So she gave me part from her house and we share the house together. Not like a landlord, but like my real sister. So I'm very proud with her. She is here, her name is Tina Fironi, and Mary, also Mary Monetary. So that is the people that they start with me, my journey here in USA. They empower me in many areas, not only sharing house or take me somewhere with Mary, but they're like my family, really, that I lost in Africa. I found them here in USA, Mary and Tina. So that is how I get my new family here in USA. So, and I start to apply for a job, but it is not working because I have to go to the American system. So, and with Tina, we do many things. Even I have my bachelor and we evaluated in Boston. And now I enrolled myself in Westfield University. So I have to do my master after they said, yeah, that is a bachelor degree really in science. So, and I applied for a job as a teacher and I'm trying to live my life and to change the life even for my kids. So my three kids now, they enjoy their school, and I know that they will have a good future here, because I believe today what you are doing about Jane Addams and what she do in the life, not in her life, but in the lives of many people. She didn't give meaning for the life only. She gave value, human right. So I believe that is the history of USA. And I believe that I am struggling in my childhood as a displaced child, again a refugee's mother, again my children here in USA, but I believe in the ability of my kids. They will never be as a displaced kids, but they will be a citizen and a good citizen for USA.
Who then, during a bombing campaign, walks over 500 miles, eventually to Juba, uses the network, and the networks are important for migrants and refugees, uses the network, uses her faith, her contact with church to get to Egypt, uses a network again to find employment, and then perseveres through at least a dozen interviews, both with UNHCR and with the US, and then ends up in this wonderful, welcoming cocoon in Westfield. I couldn't do that. I could not do that. All right, moving on. Lori?
Well, it's hard to follow that. So, I work with Center for New Americans, as was indicated, and people often ask us, well, you know, who do you serve? You know, what group of people do you see most? What nationality, what ethnicity, what language group? And the truth is, as Community Actions Needs Assessment, Claire Higgins is sitting here, as their needs assessment once indicated, which I love to quote in my proposals, the diversity of the diversity in this area is remarkable. For a rural area, it really boggles the mind. So we serve everyone. We serve Iraqi refugees who are not welcome at home because they worked with the Americans. We serve Moldovan refugees who have been here long enough that they're now becoming citizens. We serve restaurant workers from China who often have their passports held by their boss so they can pay off their debt. And they live in restaurant dormitories and work 60 hours a week right here in our community. We serve Tibetan stone workers. We serve many people with very little formal education from their home country because either their school fees were too expensive for their families or because of disruption and internal turmoil, there really is no formal schooling. We have a student in our class now from Venezuela who was a professional in her home country, but whose country slid into total chaos, made her come here, and but for her struggles with English, she should be recognized as a professional, but it's not even clear that her credentials will ever be recognized here. So she's forced to reinvent herself. We serve many people who have no documents, whose children are in the public schools, who are working on our farms, there are restaurants, cleaning hotel rooms, and they drive, although they shouldn't, in fear and trembling, because it's the only way to get children to school or to get to jobs. And when they have no heat, they cannot complain to the landlord because they have no place to go. And when they have a medical crisis on a farm, they're often dissuaded from going to a hospital because it might come out that they're working there on the farm without papers. So it's hard to understand the range of challenges and issues we see. And I think, as Jack said, I think it's important to remember that people do not leave their countries and their families and everything they know lightly. They leave because they have no option. We teach English first and foremost. Most of our students recognize that they are simply locked out of everything. Community resources, doctor's appointments, talking to a child's teacher unless they can speak English. So if students have a formal education, obviously it's easier if students speak a language that has an alphabet that's like ours. It's easier, but that's often not the case. We teach computer skills because it's practically impossible to apply for a job these days. Even the most basic entry-level job at a place like Target, you cannot apply for a job if you are not computer literate. It has to be done for you. We teach civics in all of our classes, so we teach the American form of government, we teach holidays, we teach paying your taxes. Many of our students pay their taxes even if they don't have documents. They have an ITIN and they are paying their taxes, believe it or not. We teach a lot of career pathways classes. We are actually running a class right now at Smith Vocational School for people who would like to be personal care attendants and then perhaps go on to be certified nursing assistants. There is a desperate need for these workers right now, and we serve a lot of people who come from countries where there's a helping tradition, and they make wonderful workers. And in our own act of subversion, we have admitted into that class people who have no documents. So if you know seniors who would like to pay cash for a trained healthcare worker, we have those people. Let us know, because the networks that Jack was referring to, that's how we're going to help our students. They don't have those networks, but we do. So we have people who have a certificate that shows that they've got the skills to work, and we'd like to give them alternatives to working backbreaking farm jobs. If you know people, and if you know people who are willing to help drive, we drive our students to class when they can't drive to make certain that they get here safely. So if you know people who would like to volunteer and help us, see me, email me, look for Center for New Americans online. We provide a safety net for our students. We work with a lot of volunteers who work as tutors and classroom assistants and drivers. We offer immigration legal services. We offer, besides helping people apply for citizenship, we also help them apply for green cards, for employment authorizations, for family petitions, and we are a proud member of the Immigration Protection Project, which Bill Newman and his colleagues at the ACLU and Western New England University School of Law have started, and we refer people to the IPP and we accept referrals from them. All things considered, we feel pretty fortunate. We work in sanctuary committees where the police do not believe it is their job to collaborate with ICE because they really want to keep channels of communication open, and they recognize that they will not hear anything if everybody is hiding in fear. We are fortunate to be represented by Senator Rosenberg and a very strong Western Mass delegation in our, you know, Reps Kokot and Goldstein Rose and Kulik and Seibeck and Mark, because these are folks who fight for the Safe Communities Act and for other protections that will keep our students strong, and to work with Mayor Narkowitz, who has been upfront about this community being a welcoming community. The current climate is draining. We are under attack constantly. It serves no public good that I can see, but is creating a tremendous amount of stress for our students, our clients, their children, the teachers and counselors who work with them, It's tearing families apart. It's impacting the local workforce. It's creating a tremendous amount of additional work, and there's already plenty of work to run a school year in, year out, to help people get jobs, to help people acclimate to a new culture, and now it's all kinds of additional work to fend off constantly to keep people safe. The discussion of criminals has nothing to do with the experience of our neighbors, of the people we work with. People we work with are just trying to build a life for themselves and their children. They come here with acts of courage that should be greeted with awe and support and welcome. And it is simply a stroke of luck that distinguishes someone who was born into the citizenship from someone who has worked years to attain it. We are grateful for the support that we have gotten, for volunteers who have come forward, for people who are holding fundraisers for us, because with the current administration, we cannot count on the public support we've always received, because who knows what's going to happen tomorrow. And it takes a lot of support and handholding and guidance and childcare and transportation and mentoring and coaching to get people to be able to adapt, to be in this new climate, and yet they do, you know, every day. So thank you for listening, and thank you for supporting. And
so, I want to spend just a few seconds thanking Jack Gelb for his really quite extraordinary talk, and Lori Millman for her amazing work at the Center for New Americans. And so, Arna, your talk was so full of strength and determination and humanity. Really, it's humbling to be on this panel with you. Thank you for sharing. I'm going to spend a few minutes telling you about the Immigrant Protection Project in Western Massachusetts, because I think a lot of people here probably don't know, and perhaps we can help, or you can help, individuals who could use their services. The Immigrant Protection Project came out of a meeting shortly after the last election with a number of us who had become activists during the anti-Vietnam War movement, and said we may have some skills that could be useful in what is the coming oppression from the Trump administration, and in particular with how immigrants will be targeted. So, our initial analysis that for Western Massachusetts, in terms of legal resources, is we were under-resourced and under-organized. With regard to organization, it's not that we don't have resources, and the Center for New Americans, we're now our 25 other project partners as well, there are resources. But how do you get the people who need those resources to the right place in an effective way that they will actually be taken care of? And an answer to that, our answer to help alleviate that problem, is that we have created a call center. We have 25 bilingual trained volunteers. And we are live at least 4 hours a day, and actually more now. And we will return the calls within 24 hours if we're not there live to answer them at the time. We have created an instrument which is essentially a decision tree for immigration issues. How do we get this person to the right place and the right lawyers and the right people and the right advocates so that they can receive the assistance and counseling that they need? Our call center volunteers are just extraordinary, and their volunteer work is amazing. So, we actually had to, of course, put together what are all the resources in Western Massachusetts. And this was a helpful enterprise to us, and I think helpful to the couple of hundred families who have called us since we began the project. There was another piece of IPP, the Immigrant Protection Project, and that is, this came out of our discussions with immigrant communities and their representatives. People need to be released from ICE custody when they're picked up. And there is a problem in providing immigration representation, which is that immigration law is a specialty. It just is. I did ask at one point in this project, can I see the horn book? I want the synopsis so that I can have at my fingertips this book so I can look up what I need to know. And one of our lawyers on our coordinating committee, there are eight of us on the coordinating committee, said, okay, here it is. And he hands me a book, it's 800 pages, single spaced, small font. Said, okay, I'm going back to this is complicated, this is a specialty. But in immigration court, there is one place where lawyers can enter a special appearance, that's a limited appearance, and not put in a representation, a piece of paper for the entire case, and that's for bond hearings, which is the immigration court equivalent of a bail hearing. If a person is picked up by ICE and held, they can have their so-called merits hearing. That's the determination of whether or not they're going to be what ICE calls removal, what everyone else will call deportation. Within 4 or 5 weeks, it can happen really quickly. But if you're out on bond, your case may not come up for 2 or 3 years, and a lot of good things can happen in 2 or 3 years, including putting together your entire defense to removal and or finding an avenue to status. So we thought we could find lawyers who would provide representation in bond hearings because they don't have to be immigration specialists. We can get immigration specialists to work with them on what they need to know. And a lot of lawyers, particularly criminal defense lawyers, have done hundreds, thousands of bail hearings. Why can't they do bond hearings? The answer is they can, and they do, and we've trained them. And we have done some, 15 or 20 bond hearings in immigration court with great success, and those individuals can go back to their families, can get the lawyers needed to represent them on their merits hearing, can be their breadwinner or a breadwinner for their family. And so the bond lawyer piece of our program we think is crucial, and we have, of course, a decision tree and an expedited way of helping individuals who were picked up by ICE. We had lawyers at the Franklin County Jail 2 days ago at night, the day they were picked up. There's another piece of the program that Lori Millman in particular has been very helpful with. And this comes from what was expressed to us as the need to plan for the worst. Parents are picked up. Kids are separated from their parents. How can the parents make sure the kids are taken care of? And what has come out of that is a series of documents that have been created by 8 or 10 statewide immigrant rights organizations that are family protection documents. And we have those available, we open source them, and what we have been doing in Western Massachusetts is training the trainers, the medical facilities, the community action groups, the advocacy groups, the organizing groups. Here are the documents, here's the fillable PDF, here's what you need to know. And we do a couple of hours of training for the staff. Now the staffs are doing those documents and helping those individuals so that they have at least that much authority and agency, and the government can't take that away from them. They may be able to pick them up, but they can't take away that authority from parents. I think that those family protection piece of our program is really important. We also make available to those, you know, we say roughly these forms will work for about 80% of the people or 80% of the time. We have lawyers who have volunteered in Hampshire and Franklin and Hampden County as well as in the Berkshires who say, okay, for those 20% or so for whom these documents do not necessarily solve all the issues, we will make lawyers available to them to solve those issues and to go to court when necessary. For example, with someone who needs a passport, wants a passport for a kid, and the passport administration, for reasons we've never been able to figure out, about half the time they say fine, about half the time they send them back, and they say, no, you're not necessarily the sole custodial parent, so we need to go to court to have a judge say, yes, you are. We've had a number of other issues that have come out of our IPP. So for example, our member of our coordinating committee, Buzz Eisenberg, has also been a long time cooperating attorney with the ACLU of Massachusetts. On behalf of the ACLU, he is representing Nagar Abdallah, the Iraqi national, who is now still in ICE custody, but we are representing him. We are representing individuals who have motions to suppress an immigration court, saying one of the only basis for a motion to suppress an immigration court, that you have been subjected to racial profiling, and that is how and why ICE picked you up. ICE functions regionally, does not function by state, and the region is New England. And so we are building coalitions and cross-referral networks with the law schools, not only Western New England, but the law schools in Connecticut, Yale, and UConn, Quinnipiac, and Trinity, to provide representation up and down the valley. And we're now doing our immigrant protection project training for lawyers, and we are taking it to the other ACLU affiliates in New England. So, one last thing I'll say, we also are working very closely with the various, and they are, and varied immigrant communities in Western Massachusetts. We will continue to do our work at the Franklin County Jail, and as part of our coalition partnering and work, we will begin at the end of this month, Know Your Rights training at the Franklin County Jail, which the IPP and the ACLU Massachusetts will be conducting jointly with PEAR and Central West Justice of Community Legal Aid. All of this is a community effort between the volunteer lawyers and the volunteers at the call center and our volunteer partners, and the list goes on and on. We have hundreds of people involved in this effort, because when it comes to ICE picking people up and this horrifying immigration system that we have, we can say, not in my town, not in my name, and we will fight you every step.
Minutes for questions, and would entertain anyone. I'd like to comment on, since 1980, with the passage of a more comprehensive Immigration Act, part of it was built on what was the increasing cooperation between nonprofits and the U.S. government. And so the act itself was promising. But almost from the beginning, the nonprofits stepped up, whether you're talking about Catholic Charities or our Lutheran friends. But government resources have gone like this. And it has been a reflection of our political situation, domestic political situation. And so today, and some of us here today have experienced this over the last year, the arbitrary executive orders, which by the way have a history before Donald Trump, upset the working of the federal institutions and play hell with the budgets of the nonprofits who are the resettlement agencies. And our Catholic Charity friends who've been the resettlement agency here the last year, it's very difficult for them to staff and to support. The third leg of this has been the idea of these circles of care. And that again gets us to the wonderful reception in Western Massachusetts at the community level. And it's needed now more than ever before. Because in the policy of the U.S. government presently, there's a tremendous emphasis put on an individual becoming economically independent as soon as possible. In other words, you get a job now. And there are arguments against that, which many of us support. But people entering a new culture, people who've experienced one kind of trauma or another, who need language, who need a foothold in understanding the complexity of our environment, who may be with families, they need other kinds of support. If it were me, there'd be three months of intensive language training, because that's a vehicle for exercising opportunities that had presented themselves. The center, thank God, does a good job of providing assistance to help people become acculturated, to develop the context for understanding this crazy life of ours. Any questions?
I have a question. Thank you so much for the presentations. They're all excellent. I wonder, I had a question about the IPP project. It first of all, it's amazing what you've done. And I was thinking about what you said about you knew you had a set of skills that you could put to use. And I wondered if you could talk a little bit about the strategies that you have described a little more analytically in terms of how you transferred them over from your previous work. And also, do you need more volunteers?
Thank you for that. First of all, we have some cards in back, business cards. Our number is 413-727-8515. And if people have issues related to immigration status or anything of that ilk, call us. We will respond. And we do it within 24 hours for sure. Someone's been picked up by ICE, we'll respond immediately. Calls. With regard to skills, we are always looking for bilingual Spanish and English volunteers for our call center. We will train you. We will also use those individuals as members of bond teams, as translators and interpreters, and we will also use those interpreters and translators and paralegals we will train to meet with individuals one-on-one, because much as we have used the call center and we received the Massachusetts Bar Foundation emergency grant to pay for all the equipment, the phones, the computers, and so on, to open the project in the spring of this year, that we need those volunteers and we will train. And it's quite an experience. And it's really, I think, both humbling and I think energizing for those call center volunteers. We really want bilingual English, Spanish. We have other language volunteers as well, but that's our primary need. In terms of utilizing skills, this is a community response. There are community groups who organize, and community groups who provide specialized services, and community groups who provide some immigrant legal services. And this is something we are all in it together, and I think that this notion of how do we organize, how do we stay together, how do we not hang alone, but how do we hang together, is crucially important. Because if we don't hang together, we will, Benjamin Franklin, we will hang alone. But I think that the skills to understand how we need to work together to organize both politically and socially in our community are the same skills. They've always been the same skills. And everyone who has been in movement work, going back everyone who is here today who has had any kind of that experience, I think can find a place to plug into, either with our project or some other projects here in the Valley, because this is our Valley, this is not ISIS Valley.
One more question? I've got a plug. Yes, back there. Please.
Right here.
Just wondered how Sanctuary interfaces with the work of your project.
How Sanctuary what?
Interfaces with the work that you're doing, because I have a lot of friends working on it up here in Boston, and their places are empty, and you know, it's just around.
Talking about religious sanctuary.
Yes, religious sanctuary. Yes.
So we have a number of lawyers in our coordinating committee, and we have been advising a number of congregations with regard to sanctuary. It's a subject actually that will come up. This is a meeting at the Unitarian Society, I think, for the Unitarian Society of Northampton tomorrow. We've met with other congregations and other religious leaders, and we will continue to provide that advice. How does it fit? Because it's part of the struggle, and it's important, and it talks to our values and our morals and our commitment and our resistance. And I'm so proud of what this Valley is doing, what the religious institutions in this Valley are doing to say, you are welcome in our home.
We have one more.
they are deathly afraid. You know, you read a headline like the other day, the three workers on their way home who got picked up by ICE. What do you tell people who are below the radar and afraid to come forward for the kind of help that, you know, you folks offer? The fear factor that people have wanting to stay below the radar.
There may not be a magic answer, but if the person calls us, we will do a complete intake. We will examine what are all of the potential avenues for some relief in immigration, either a way to status or a defense to deportation or removal should the person be picked up. We will make the appropriate referrals, and some people who are below the radar actually have avenues to status that they don't know about. So I understand the fear. I think the fear is real. Genuine, and it is in fact justified, although we have not had the kinds of sweeps or raids that we feared would happen here. They haven't, which is not to say that individuals are not at risk, because they are, but if someone calls us, we will do everything we can to get them to the appropriate person, appropriate advocacy or lawyer, to see if there's some way that they can achieve status and or defense, so maybe they can breathe easier.
Another one more question. I'd like to plug a book which Rhett introduced to me. It's just out a couple months. And if you want to deep dive and you want to be moved by the plight of people on the move, The New Odyssey by Patrick Kinsley, who spent several years with people on the move to Europe, to Turkey. It's a tough read, but it's enlightening. So, Jane Addams, I thank my friends here. I think Jane Addams would be pleased with the work that they're doing, the commitments they've made, and what they will continue to do with neighbors, and with migrants, for migrants, and with refugees. I want to thank them.
This has been quite a morning, and thank you all. The panelists and people working.